camp meeting. Amen. And if I haven't spoken to you individually, I welcome you to Smyrna camp meeting. It's a blessing to be here, and I don't know about you, but God has blessed this week so far. We symbolically hold in our hands brilliant truths given us by God, clear understandings that were beyond the comprehension of God's people in times past. They had bits and pieces of truth, some large, some small, but today all those pieces have coalesced into a wonderful whole. These truths have grown into great pillars strategically placed by God and stand fixed and immovable. Nothing man can do can change them, though enemies lie in wait to attack and destroy. And the sanctuary is one of those outstanding pillars. In fact, its theology unifies all the principles of our faith. If you think about it, all the principles are there of our faith. And it stands head and shoulders above all others, second in magnificence only to the God, to our Father and the Son. For it is a reflection of their immeasurable beauty of character and of the total plan of redemption. Like sunlight, light streams from this pillar to the surrounding pillars of truth, where each, tall or short, give witness to the greatness of God, and light from this pillar can also illuminate with renewed splendor old but important truth. This morning, the beauty of an old truth will, I pray, shine forth with new splendor. Walter McMillian was on death row for a crime he insisted he had not committed. "I know it may not matter to you," he said to his new attorney, "but it's important to me that you know that I'm innocent and didn't do what they said I did, not no kind of way. I'm sure I'm not the first person on death row to tell you that they're innocent, but it's important to me for you to believe me. This burden they've put on me is more than I can bear." And his lip began to quiver. Before incarceration, Walter McMillian lived in Monroe County, Alabama, owned a pulpwood business, and was pleasant, respectful, and well-liked by his customers and community alike, until the day the only child of a local respected family was found dead in the dry cleaning shop where she worked, shot 3 times in the back. And Walter McMillian became the chief suspect, for the young lady was white and Walter was black. And Walter had been known to have been in a close relationship with a white woman. And so, in those days in Alabama, race was a big issue. It was 1986, and lynchings were still a threat. Then a disreputable man with a long history of lying to the police claimed that Walter had murdered that young lady and he had been there to see it happen. Well, it soon became apparent that Walter and this man had never met, and that there was no clear evidence that Walter had been there. But public pressure was intense on law enforcement to solve this crime, and Walter, as I said, was the chief suspect. He because he had been foolish enough to be involved in a close relationship with a white woman and was therefore considered dangerous and possibly even capable of committing the crime. The police fabricated an assault charge about Walter so that they could arrest him. And he was arrested on this fraudulent assault charge. His arrest was accompanied by racial slurs, insults, threats of lynching by the police force. Then another unreliable witness came forward and said he had seen Walter's truck race away from the dry cleaners at the time of the murder. But family members and church members, at least a dozen of them, all stated that Walter had been with them on the day of the murder. They had gathered at Walter's house. In fact, because he lived on a main road and they had planned to fish fry and they were going to sell this on a roadside stand. And even during this time, a friend came over and helped Walter replace the transmission in his truck, so it couldn't have possibly been at the dry cleaners at that time. It couldn't go anywhere. A police officer even stopped at the roadside stand and purchased some food and noted in his log that Walter was there with a number of church members and family members. Still, Walter was indicted and placed on death row before his trial and remained there for over a year until his trial. His cell was windowless. In fact, the whole housing unit was windowless and notoriously hot and uncomfortable. Temperatures in August reached over 100 degrees for days and sometimes weeks at a time. When his trial finally took place, it was before a white jury, save one, and it only lasted a day and a half. He was convicted, taken back to prison in chains and handcuffs, deliberately tightened to be uncomfortable. I have a purpose for telling you all this, but let me go on just a little bit more. Years later, Mr. Stevenson became Walter's new lawyer. 2 weeks after accepting his case, he received a call from Judge Key, who had presided over Walter's trial back years earlier. And he spoke to Mr. Stevenson and said, "Why on earth do you want to represent someone like Walter McMillian? Don't you know he's one of the biggest drug dealers in all of South Alabama? You don't want anything to do with this case. He's probably even part of the Dixie Mafia and who knows what else." And he went on to say how he was going to obstruct one part or another of Stevenson's planning for a new hearing. But Mr. Stevenson persisted, and he obtained a post-conviction evidentiary hearing where he presented to the judge and jury the multiple ways Walter's rights had been violated. The Israelites had to deal with crimes against mankind just as we do. Crimes such as manslaughter and premeditated murder. But our issues are much more complex. We have to deal with wrongful convictions discovered after lengthy sentences have been served or partially served, and sometimes after years have been spent on death row. We have to deal with an appeal process that can be drawn out and seemingly indifferent to the innocent waiting in jail. We have to deal with the biases of those in authority for unreliable or inaccurate information as long as it goes along with our predetermined opinion of guilt. And we have to deal with the tolerance, just the tolerance, most of the world has for unfair prosecutions and convictions as long as it gets the case closed. After all, most of the world is not called before the bar of justice and is not hurting. They can drive and work and shop. without feeling the cruel consequences of false accusations. Many people are guilty for the crimes for which they are sentenced, but some are not. And the innocent can spend years fighting for the return of their former lives while they wait within the darkness of a prison complex where they face more injustice and inhumanity from inmates and guards alike. We live in a terrible world. Nonetheless, within the hearts of the innocent fighting for justice linger bits of hope, for their hope has been shattered, and within their hearts remain remnants of personal humanity and dignity, known only in a full sense in their past when love and family were freely shared. Not all who live behind locked doors have become hardened to the core. Humanity does persist. Now let's consider for a moment the trespasses done against Walter. Obvious are the acceptance of unreliable witnesses and the rejection of credible testimonies, the fabricated charge of assault in order to arrest him, his placement on death row before he was convicted, even before his trial, the racial slurs and threats of lynching by law enforcement, and the coercion of a judge in an attempt to prevent a post-conviction hearing. But in God's sight, trespasses are much broader and encompass more than these. Prior to the institution of the sanctuary services, trespasses and their restitutions and/or consequences were outlined by God in the various laws and ordinances given to the Israelites through Moses at Mount Sinai, such as what happens when a man smites another and causes his death, or what happens when someone steals something, or when someone causes the loss of someone's harvest. Usury was forbidden, as well as taking advantage of widows and children, and the maltreatment of servants was also forbidden. Trespasses always involved restitution or the loss of the offender's life. We read all of this in Exodus 21 onward. But when the tabernacle was established, offerings for trespasses were also established. These offerings always included restitution. The process is delineated in Leviticus 5 onward. Trespasses included deliberate sin, such as when one refused to speak up as a witness in a court-type setting when that person had knowledge of the case, or when one had been careless or neglectful about laws of cleanliness or about what he had sworn he would do. Trespasses also occurred against the holy things of the Lord, in which one unknowingly did things forbidden by God. And trespasses also occurred when one knowingly did things against his neighbors, such as stealing from them or engaging in false swearing, violence, or deception concerning them. The Bible explains how the offerings were to be carried out and how restitution was determined. Let's open our Bibles and read one verse in particular, Leviticus 5, 15. Which says, if a soul commit a trespass and sin through ignorance in the holy things of the Lord, then he shall bring for his trespass unto the Lord a ram without blemish out of the flocks, with thy estimation by shekels of silver after the shekel of the sanctuary, for a trespass offering. And the Lord is speaking to Moses. Moses is the one making the estimation. Now, the Hebrew phrase that we read in this verse, commit a trespass, is translated from two Hebrew words, ma'al and ma'al. Both are spelled the same way, but have different subscripts to distinguish them. One is a verb, the other is a noun. And it's like saying if a person transgress a transgression or trespass a trespassing, it's a little awkward. We don't usually speak that way, but we do sometimes. We say, I dreamed a dream. And it's using the same, it's kind of like, it's not quite an oxymoron, but how can you dream when you're already, you know? Anyway, we say the same thing, and this is what the Hebrew is saying here, ma'al, ma'al. You put the emphasis in a different place. It has different subscripts, spelled the same way, ma-al, and it just means trespass, a trespassing, or transgress, a transgression. It's used several times in the Old Testament, and in all its translations, the verb means to act unfaithfully or treacherously, or to cover up something by falsehood, with falsehood or with stealth. And this unfaithfulness in the Old Testament included worship of a false god, marriage to a foreign woman, false judgments, adultery, the violation of an obligation to the Lord, or the violation of His word. And I have all the texts here. If you want them later, you can have them. But let's now, and here I have these beautiful sequoias. They remind me of the great pillars of our faith, standing head and shoulders, so to speak, of other important pillars, but the sanctuary in particular, I think of. Now, next slide, and then we'll move on. The trespass offerings are summarized in a few places in the scripture. Leviticus 5, 1 to 19, Leviticus 6, 1 to 7, Leviticus 7, 1 to 7, Numbers 5, 5 to 8, and its precursors are in Exodus chapters 21, 22, and 23. Now, we want to just review a little bit the types of trespasses that are delineated in Leviticus. For example, a credible witness who doesn't speak up when he could speak up to help a person in a court setting. Carelessness, indifference, or neglect about ceremonial cleanliness, or neglect or carelessness about fulfilling a vow or an oath you've made. Also, transgressions against the holy things of the Lord. And I just want to stop there. What does that mean? The Bible doesn't tell us what transgression against the holy things of the Lord is, and neither does Ellen White. And so we can only try to interpret this, and one way would be that if a priest did something ignorantly that was against protocol in the sanctuary service, that could be a transgression of the against the holy things of the Lord. But I want to look at the next slide and just remind you that these priests were carefully instructed in all that they were supposed to do. They were so well instructed. Here in Signs of the Times, August 28, 1893, we read, "The offering for sin was a most solemn, sacred offering, and was placed upon the altar with impressive ceremony, and every detail was explained by the priest to the people, that they might understand that the Son of God was to be made an offering for their sins." The important part is, every detail was explained to the people. They knew this, but it's still possible they did something unknowingly against protocol or left something out. But there's something else to consider, and that's, going back. One more. please. A cross-reference to Exodus 22:20-31. So let's just look at that. Exodus 22. Near the end, 29, starting in verse 29. And I, instead of waiting, I'm going to speed on because I know we have a big afternoon coming up. Okay, starting in verse 27. No, 29. Thou shalt not delay to offer the first of thy ripe fruits and of thy liquors. The firstborn of thy sons shalt thou give unto me. Likewise shalt thou do with thine oxen and with thy sheep. 7 days it shall be with his dam. On the eighth day thou shalt give it to me. And ye shall be holy men unto me. And we'll stop there. There were things the people were to offer to the Lord. And these were holy things. And if they failed to do that, or if they procrastinated or were negligent, this also might be a way that they sinned, people sinned against the holy things of the Lord. Okay, we're going to move on to slide 5. Another way of trespassing, this is a review, was deception concerning a neighbor, false swearing. Now, if we go to the next slide, the precursors before the sanctuary was set up is delineated in Exodus about when you trespassed against someone, for example, being responsible for the death of another. God outlined with through Moses what would happen if you were responsible for the death of another. That's in most of that is in chapter 21. If you were responsible for the injury to another, or even for the kidnapping of another. If you stole a person for the purpose of selling that person into slavery, you see, that was a trespass. And there were consequences for that, and God outlined that through Moses. Theft was another trespass. Being responsible for the loss of another's harvest. For example, if you started a fire in your field and it got out of control and destroyed the field of grain in your neighbor's field of grain, that was a trespass against him. And there was, of course, restitution to be made. Next slide. Being responsible for the loss of your neighbor's livestock when your neighbor left that livestock in your care and you were negligent or not taking care of that livestock, that was a trespass. If you borrowed something and what you borrowed became damaged, that was a trespass also, and there were consequences and restitution that had to be made. And if you were a male and had a close relationship with a maid, you were responsible for that maid and the consequences of your actions. Now, all of those are examples of trespasses, and we're talking about the trespass offering. Well, and after we get the groundwork laid, it's going to come home to us and maybe be more interesting to you. But let's consider first, what is the definition of a trespass? What I've given you so far are examples. For example, if I examples of a car might be a Chevy, a Ford, etc. But what is a trespass? And the first time we read about trespass is in Genesis 31:36, and then in 50:17, and then again in Exodus, where I refer this back to. And the Hebrew word for trespass in these examples is pesha. And pesha means crime, offense, evil doing, transgression. And so these things in Exodus that I briefly mentioned, one place in particular talks about that being a trespass. It's an evil doing. It's a crime. But when we move on to Leviticus, a different word, and we read about trespass offering, it's a different Hebrew word. It's a sham. And a sham means an offering for a transgression in which restitution can be calculated and given as compensation. So now we're moving into the sanctuary service, and one of the offerings is the trespass offering. And the built into this word asham is that restitution can be calculated and given to the victim. And that's why we read Leviticus, next slide, 5:15. Three times in that text, trespass is used. The first time, ma'al is used. The next two times, it's asham. And so the first time, if a soul commit a trespass, that's ma'al. That means if a soul acts unfaithfully, treacherously, works with stealth, then he is to bring an asham. And the asham is something that can be calculated and not only given as restitution to the victim, but also it involves our God. Now, let's look at the next slide. Trespass offering for the holy things of the Lord. The Bible outlines the protocol to do this. A ram without blemish is to be brought, and the texts are there. An estimation by Moses in shekels of silver, and that is to be given to the priest. And an additional fifth part was to also be given to the priest. And then, see, that's the restitution part. That's the calculation part. But there's another part. There are like two parts in this trespass offering. This other part is like a sin offering. A ram is to be brought. The ram is offered. The priest does that, and atonement is made for him, and it shall be forgiven him. That's for the holy things of the Lord. The next slide that's up is a trespass offering for anything that God has forbidden. Again, a ram is to be brought without blemish. Moses makes an estimation. The priest makes an atonement, and it shall be forgiven him. And in this case, one other part is added. And that part is the person has trespassed against the Lord. And this is important. If I steal something from Brother Allen and then it's lost, I have to, first of all, confess and ask forgiveness, and I have to replace that and also add a little extra. Brada, is that what they call it in Jamaica? And when you buy something, add a little extra. But that's taking care of him. But I've also trespassed against the Lord, and that we'll get to in a minute. Now, next slide. Trespass offering for those against the Lord involving a neighbor. When one has harmed his neighbor, it was, it's very clearly delineated here in 6:2. When one harms his neighbor, it's considered, before anything else is given in this chapter, a trespass against the Lord. Then we are instructed that they were to restore that which was taken or lost, restore in principle, and add a fifth part, and that is given to the victim. And also, there's two parts to this, the restoration and the sin offering that's brought as a trespass offering to the Lord, because you've trespassed against the Lord also. The priest makes an atonement, and it shall be forgiven him. Now, I'd like to compare, and this, you know, so much is in the scripture that maybe we really don't understand. But the next slide, I want to compare sin offering with trespass offering, because remember, in a trespass offering, there are two parts. And one part is very similar to a sin offering. So are there any differences between if you just bring a sin offering or if you're bringing a trespass offering to the Lord? And yes, there's a very important difference. In the sin offering, it provided a graduated scale of sacrifices according to the position and the financial resources of the transgressor, ranging from a bullock to turtle doves and pigeons and even a little flower, whatever you was appropriate for you. That was available to you through the sin offering. In the trespass offering, however, they were not scaled. They were required to bring a ram along with restoration of what had been taken plus one-fifth the value of the property in question. And so if you were a very poor person and normally could only bring a little meal for a sin offering. If you trespassed against the Lord and your neighbor, there was no way to just bring a little. You had to bring a ram, like everyone had to bring a ram, and I imagine this made a big difference in the minds of people before they trespassed against each other. Okay, the next bullet. There was one law for the way the sin offering was to be dispensed and for the way the sin offering portion of the trespass offering was to be dispensed. The Bible says that, Leviticus 7:7. But there is a little difference concerning the blood. In a sin offering for a ruler or a common person, the blood was put on the horns of the altar and the rest poured out at the bottom of the altar, and I have the text there. In a sin offering for a priest or for the congregation, the blood was sprinkled before the veil of the sanctuary, placed on the horns of the altar of sweet incense, it's called, and the rest poured out at the bottom of the altar of burnt offerings. In a burnt offering, the blood was sprinkled upon the altar round about, except if birds were sacrificed. In a peace offering, the blood was sprinkled upon the altar round about. In the offering of consecration of Aaron, etc., the blood was sprinkled round about upon the altar. And in a trespass offering, the blood was sprinkled around the altar. So in a sin offering, it was placed on the horns or taken inside and sprinkled before the veil and placed on the altar of sweet offering, but not in a trespass offering. It always stayed at the burnt altar of burnt offering. And the Bible says in 7:1 that the blood was sprinkled around the altar. Why there is a difference? We'd have to study that more. Perhaps you understand it. Now, that's the basics. Now we're going to move in to modern times. From M.L. Andreasen, The Sanctuary Service, pages 167 and 168, 2006 edition. And before I read this, I just want you to picture Andreasen. He taught at our seminary. He taught future ministers. And these chapters in the Sanctuary Service book are his lectures that he gave to these ministers. And this is what he had to say about the trespass offering. Quote, a vital part of the plan of redemption, as far as man is concerned, is that of restitution. Conviction of sin is not enough. Sorrow for sin is not enough. Confession of sin is not enough. Though all these are good and steps toward the kingdom, they are not enough. They must be accompanied by a repentance so deep and thorough that the soul will not rest until every step has been taken and every effort made to rectify past mistakes. These will, in most cases, include restitution, paying back that which we have stolen, and making every effort to right wrongs. Trespasses include questionable business transactions, fraudulent representation of values, giving wrong impressions for selfish motives, downright crookedness. It includes sharp deals to the disadvantage of the poor and the grinding down of the needy for profit. It includes exorbitant charges of all kinds, excessive interest on money loans, dishonest work for the wages received. It includes taking advantage of the misfortunes of others and demanding more than is just for services rendered merely because the other person is in a position where he cannot help himself. And I'll stop there. We've all been on the road and have had a breakdown, perhaps, and we're dependent on strangers to fix our car. There are some good strangers to fix cars, and there are some that take advantage. These are trespasses, what Andreasen is saying. For these and many other things, restitution must be made wherever possible. And where it cannot be done, it may be well to follow the instruction of old And he says, may be well. Alan White is more specific. But he says, it may be well to follow the instruction of old, that where it is impossible to make restitution to the person concerned, where not even a near kinsman can be found, let the trespass be recompensed unto the Lord, even to the priest. Numbers 5:8. The present day application of this instruction would demand that the money involved should be given to or used in the Lord's work. End quote for Andreasen. Now let's consider Zacchaeus, Luke 19:1-9. We probably all know the story, but let's just read it together. 1-9. And Jesus entered and passed through Jericho. And behold, there was a man named Zacchaeus, which was the chief among the publicans, and he was rich. And he sought to see Jesus, who he was, and could not for the press, because he was of little stature. And he ran before and climbed up into a sycamore tree to see him, for he was to pass that way. And when Jesus came to the place, he looked up, and he saw him, and said unto him, Zacchaeus, make haste, come down, for today I must abide at thy house. And he made haste and came down and received him joyfully. And when they saw it, they all murmured, saying that he was gone to be guest with a man that is a sinner. And Zacchaeus stood and said unto the Lord, behold, Lord, the half of my goods I give to the poor, and if I have taken anything from any man by false accusation, I restore him fourfold. And Jesus said unto him, this day is salvation come to thy house, for so much as he also is a son of Abraham. Now, that we're reading about restoration here. And Jesus says, this day is salvation come. Now, we're a quotation from MS, there you have it, 102, 1894. And behold, there was a man named Zacchaeus, which was the chief among the publicans, and he was rich. We just read that. This calling of a publican was thought most abominable by the Jews, and it was not calculated to refine the character. Reading on in Desire of Ages 5:5-2, Zacchaeus was a Jew and detested by his countrymen, yet the wealthy customs officer was not altogether the hardened man of the world that he seemed. Beneath the appearance of worldliness and pride was a heart susceptible to divine influences. And I just want to stop there, and let's just go back to the prison inmates when I said not all of them are hardened to the core. If you've been involved in prison ministry, and Leanne and I have in years past, and I know probably some of you have also, yes, they're there, maybe legitimately so, but they're not all hardened to the core. Just like Zacchaeus, he was a rich publican and detested by his countrymen, but he wasn't hardened to the core. He was touched. Going on, Zacchaeus had heard of Jesus, the report of one who had borne himself with kindness and courtesy toward the proscribed classes had spread far and wide, and this chief of the publicans was awakened a longing for a better life. Only a few miles from Jericho, John the Baptist had preached at the Jordan, and Zacchaeus had heard of the call to repentance. The instruction to the publicans, exact no more than what is appointed you, Luke 3:13, though outwardly disregarded, had impressed his mind. And we stop there. We know people that we want to worship God with us, and they're outwardly disregarding it. But keep praying, because you don't know what has settled in their hearts and minds that may bloom one day. And I think of my children. You think of other people, I'm sure, or maybe your children. We can't stop, because seeds have been sown. And God can bring a rich harvest if we just have faith. Okay, Zacchaeus, he knew the scriptures. and he was convicted that his practice was wrong. Now, hearing the words reported to have come from the great teacher, he felt that he was a sinner in the sight of God. Yet, what he had heard of Jesus kindled hope in his heart. Repentance, reformation of life was possible, even to him. Was not one of the new teacher's most trusted disciples a publican? Zacchaeus began at once to follow the conviction that had taken hold upon him and to make restitution to those whom he had wronged. That's Desire of Ages 552. Now, just to summarize the example of Zacchaeus that we read in Luke 19, especially verses 8 through 10. Zacchaeus was chief among the publicans, the worst of the worst. But his restitution included the poor. He hadn't harmed the poor, but his heart was so moved by the goodness of God that he gave half of his goods to the poor. He must have been pretty rich. And he restored not just an accurate restoration with one-fifth added, he restored fourfold to anyone from whom he had stolen by false accusation. And Jesus said, "This day has salvation come to your house." Now, why did Jesus not send Zacchaeus to the temple to make a trespass offering? That was part of the sacrificial services. Now, why did he not do that? Well, just think for a minute. Zacchaeus stood before the Son of God. Did he have to go to the temple where men were to make this offering? No. God accepted him right there. And that's beautiful, because we don't have sanctuaries, but I'm going to get to it next. Now, our trespass offering. Not next, but soon. In a morning talk to the ministers assembled at the General Conference session in Battle Creek, Michigan, November 1883, Ellen White asked, "Are we in the faith?" And then she said, "Dear brethren, examine yourselves whether ye be in the faith." 2 Corinthians 13:5. Many may respond, "Why, yes, I'm in the faith. I believe every point of the truth." She's speaking here. But do you practice what you believe? Are you at peace with God and with your brethren? Can you pray with sincerity, "Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors"? And this is taken in the next few slides, and the very important one that's coming at the end, from Gospel Workers 92, pages 429 and 432. I say that for those listening long distance. And then she asked, "Are you estranged from your brother because you think he has injured you?" Now, when we studied in Sabbath school about the sanctuary service several months back, and this is where I learned about the trespass service offering, I explained to the people in my Sabbath school class that I'm of the habit, have been of the habit, that when I've been injured, that I just withdraw. You know, I don't make a scene, I try not to make a scene. I'm getting better, right, honey? And I don't, you know, I try not to aggravate, I just withdraw. But when we studied again in Sabbath school about meekness, that's not being meek, because she tells us that when we are harmed by others and they make us hurt, they make us cry, or mentally or even physically, that withdrawing is not being meek. What we do need to do is withdraw if we have to and go on our knees before the Lord. And you know, there's a great bank in heaven. I call it the exchange bank, where all of these hurts go up to that bank. And in exchange from that bank, we get the ability to go back to that situation with meekness and try to make peace there. Just withdrawing is not being meek. I thought it was. I'm not creating. I'm not aggravating. But God requires more, and sometimes we're not right able to do it. But that's when we go to the Lord and say, explain, he knows already, but we explain. And in that exchange system, he keeps his record, and he gives me goodness and the ability to help soothe the situation. Anyway, getting back, are you estranged from your brother because you think he has injured you? Usually we think, well, I've injured someone, I've got to go to that person and make things right. But if you are hurting because someone has injured you, this is also a problem. This is something that needs to be dealt with. Okay, she also says, is there heart burning among you? And that's another way of saying anger. Is there bitterness in your heart? She's asking all of this to the ministers. Is there envying? Is there jealousy? Is there evil surmising? Is there misjudging of your brethren? Is there emulation? Emulation means you strive to be better than the other person. Is there a desire for special favor, honors, and supremacy? Many are filled with self-importance and esteem themselves above their brethren. Some pride themselves on being outspoken, blunt and rough, and they call this frankness. But it is not rightly named, she says. It is selfishness of the deepest dye. These persons have virtues. They may be liberal, have kind impulses, but their discourteous manners render them almost insupportable. They criticize, they wound, they say disagreeable things. Does the character they are cultivating represent Jesus? Will it fit them for the society of heaven? Let them learn to speak gently, quietly, even under circumstances the most trying. Let us control not only our words, but our thoughts and imaginations. Let's be kind, courteous, etc. And this all plays into how we're going to conclude. But the last part of this quotation is what impressed me and made a change in my life. We profess a great and holy faith, and our character must be in accordance with that faith. We all know that. With God's great moral standard, we know that. Let us shun every mean action, all dishonesty, all overreaching. We should know that. And if anyone is guilty of wrong in this respect, let him confess his sin and make restitution to the one he has wronged. We've learned that so far. And in addition, bring a trespass offering to God, that when the times of refreshing shall come, his sins may be blotted out and his name retained in the book of life. Now all of us want that. And all of us have thought, I've confessed my sins and gotten forgiveness, even if maybe we've restored that which we've harmed someone else with. But have we ever done this next part? This next part is just as important, brothers and sisters, and I'm not saying it because Smyrna has any interest in the next part, but I am saying it because your salvation, it's life and death issue, because she says it's connected with your sins being blotted out and your name retained in the Lamb's Book of Life. And so when I learned this in my little Sabbath school, preparing for Sabbath school class, which was a Friday evening, I prayed a lot with God about this, because we're going to see in future slides, but our words are trespasses. It's not just if I've embezzled or if I've done something outwardly that we can see, you know, that I have to restore, if I've stolen something from my neighbor and restore. It's our words also. When our words hurt someone, that's a trespass. And I've certainly done that over my lifetime many times. And I can't remember them all. I can't even remember a tiny bit of them. Think about it, my age. I've lived long enough to have spoken in haste, spoken with impatience, criticized, whatever. And it's going to get to our thoughts in a minute, so hang on. But so how do I make a trespass offering? It's required of me if I want to share heaven with our Heavenly Father. And so how do I do this in the best way? Because I can't remember everyone I've spoken to harmfully. I'm sorry, my mind is in a deep, dark place as far, and I'm sure yours is too. If you try to remember 20 years ago what you did and said, it's gone. But it's on our records, brothers and sisters, just as faithfully as a picture is taken of you right now. And so how do I make restitution? Well, the Lord and I prayed, and the best thing to do then is to bring an offering, a trespass offering, to whomever you want in God's work. Smyrna has no interest in that part. It's whatever you and the Lord decide. But the next Sabbath I was here in church, and the next Sabbath, that Sabbath, I put my offering in because I didn't want to risk driving home 2 hours and have an accident. It just is that important. And so that's why we're talking about it this morning. Okay, now, just to examples from Ellen White to show that our words are also trespasses, not just stealing and pushing someone over a cliff and murder and so forth. Our words. Have they used the talent of speech given them to offer praise and thanksgiving to God in hurting and discouraging any of God's children? Have they used the precious gift of God, the voice, to bruise the soul of saint and sinner? If they have done this, let them put all the things right by removing the poisonous sting. Then let them bring their trespass offering to God. And another way to bring your trespass offering, it's not just this way, but another way is let them bring their soul, their tongue, their words to the altar of God to be used to glorify Him, and He will accept the offering. Next one, letter 46, 1888. Will you now turn to the Lord fully? Will you press your case to the throne of grace? Will you bring to the Lord an honest tithe, the offerings He claims from you? Bring to God a trespass offering and a thank offering. I just want to stop there. We all know what tithe is. We know what free will offerings are. We're learning this morning what a trespass offering is. I don't have time to even talk about thank offerings, but God requires this also. Some of you may know I'm healing from a deadly disease. God has been good to me. Whether you agree with how I'm healing or not, I still say God has been good to me, and I'm thankful for that. I'm thankful for this day of life. And so, thank offerings are part of my offerings also. But the next part of this is so important. Bring a trespass and a thank offering because He has not allowed the enemy of souls to do with you as He has done with some who have had light and truth but did not walk therein. He did not, after a time, rebuke the devourer, but let him do his will with those who have thus placed themselves on his ground. And they were cut off by disease or instant death without any time of repentance. And it doesn't take much thinking to go back to Orlando just last week. They were cut off. They were on Satan's ground without any time for repentance. It could be a car accident. It could be a heart attack. You don't know. The next 5 minutes is not guaranteed to any of us. And so our thank offering should include this concept that God is not allowing the devourer to do with us as He allows the devourer to do with those who are not walking and deliberately not walking in God's ways. A thank offering is appropriate. To review, every mean action, just in the part that we've read, there's much more, but in the part we've read, every mean action, pardon me, all dishonesty, all overreaching, she talks about, all using speech to hurt or discourage, using the voice to bruise the soul of saint or sinner, or having light and truth and not walking in it. These are things that are like trespasses. And next slide, just to prove that trespasses involve our words. She says it would be well to have a trespass offering box in sight and have all the household agree that whoever speaks unkindly of another or utters angry words should drop into the trespass offering box. Okay, pardon me. What do we do when we cannot make restitution? She tells us, pardon me. For example, if you worked in a workplace and were dishonest, it's 20 years later or even 5 years later, that workplace is closed down, the owner has moved, you have no way of knowing to whom you can make your restitution. It's closed down, it's gone. What do we do when we cannot make restitution? Speaking to a sharp, scheming man, she said, and this is taken from 5T 339, Zacchaeus declared, if I've taken anything from any man by false accusation, I restore him fourfold. You could at least have made efforts to correct your acts of injustice to your fellow men. You cannot make every case right. For some whom you have injured have gone into the graves, and the account stands registered against you. You may have asked forgiveness, I'm stopping, these are my words. You may have confessed your sin, and you think, that's it, I can't make restitution, that's all I need to do. But she says, the account stands registered against you. In these cases, the best you can do is bring a trespass offering to the altar of the Lord, and he will accept and pardon you. But where you can, you should make reparation to the wronged ones. What if I can't remember what I've done? We have lived a lifetime of evil, don't you think so? We've had shining moments of goodness, yes, and we are learning how to, by God's grace, to be more like him. But up to this point, if you're like me and I look back, and we'll talk more. What if we can't remember? And I want to tell you now about the genome. Maybe you already know the genome. Dr. Ricardo Sabatini is here with 5 library carts of 175 massive volumes containing the human genome of Craig Venter. This is all it takes. This is everything that describes, and if we were God, we could make another Craig Venter, because it's everything. Now, next slide. Our genomes are made of DNA. And within DNA, there are 4 bases, adenine A, cytosine C, guanine G, and thymine T. Only 4 letters are used in the human genomic code. Human genomes contain more than 3 billion of these bases in various combinations. And for Craig Venter, it took 175 massive volumes on 5 library carts to write it all down. And the sequences they are combined in determine everything about us, from eye color, height, and the diseases we will develop. Here's an example. I don't know if you can see it, but it's just tiny letters filling the page front and back of these 4 letters, these bases. And here, this man, Roberto Sabatini, is pointing to just one sequence. A-A-G-A-A-T-A-T-A. And that would be adenine, adenine, guanine, adenine, adenine, thymine, adenine. Is that right? Thymine, adenine. Those 9 letters out of over 3 billion determine his eye color. Now, the next slide is another. He took another book off of these carts and pointed to this next sequence of 9 letters. And it's a sequence we all have. I should tell you, of all those 175 volumes, 174 and a half, we all have. You and me, everyone has. It's identical. It's only like 500 pages that are unique to you out of 172,000 pages or something like that. But here, in this sequence of ATTCTTGATT, in this particular place in the genomic code, we all have that, unless you have cystic fibrosis. If you have cystic fibrosis, two of the letters are missing in that particular sequence. And it's cystic fibrosis is a terrible disease. There is no cure for it. And Leon's family has experienced that. Now, so we have the human genome filling those massive volumes, just page after page of code. But there's a bigger volume, and I call it the man-gnome. And the man-gnome is a faithful history of each one of us. It has our words, our actions, our thoughts, our intents, our influence. It's all recorded. I don't like to think of that, brothers and sisters. If I'm not there, you're going to read all about it in heaven, of my man-gnome, and it's not very nice. And so, but all of my words, all of my actions, my thoughts, my intents, influence, for example, Review and Herald, August 7, 1888, all that we do, all that we say is transferred to the books of heaven. Signs of the Times, February 18, 1903, every thought, every word is recorded in the books of heaven. You might think, well, I'm not saying anything bad. If it's here, it's recorded. Next slide. The great heavenly artist is taking cognizance of every act, every word, and that even the thoughts and intents of the heart are faithfully recorded. That's Review and Herald, March 11, 1880. Then Signs of the Times, May 26, 1890. There is a witness ever present with you, who reads the motives, who knows the thoughts and purposes of the heart. And then this, and dot, 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 there is not relevant half sentence or so here. But now she's talking about things like church board meetings or any kind of meeting where, she says, in councils or assemblies where differences of views are to be discussed, and we all have a different view, for example, where differences of views are to be discussed, you should remember that the master of assemblies is with you. Unfairness, hard speeches, efforts to turn others away from an impartial decision will all be recorded in the books of heaven. And so what I gather from this, besides all, everything's recorded, is that when we're in meetings where differences of opinions are being discussed and decisions have to be made, we can state our point of view, but we're not to try to push our point of view on someone else. We're to let them make their decisions. Okay, next slide. Every self-denial, every sacrifice is faithfully recorded and will bring its reward. Next slide. Every true purpose and every act of right doing will be recorded in the book of life. We're not all bad, brothers and sisters, especially, you know, as we grow and learn. We're helping, we're unselfish, we do things. This is recorded also. You all have an influence, she says, and this is taken from 3T 363. You all have an influence, for good or for evil, on the minds and characters of others, and just the influence which you exert is written in the book of records in heaven. An angel is attending you and taking record of your words and actions when you rise in the morning. Do you feel your helplessness and your need of strength from God? And do you humbly, heartily make known your wants to your Heavenly Father? I'm putting this in because if we do, and we should, God promises, if so, angels mark your prayers. And if these prayers have not gone forth out of feigned lips, when you are in danger of unconsciously doing wrong and exerting an influence which will lead others to do wrong, your guardian angel will be by your side, prompting you to a better course, choosing your words for you, and influencing your actions. We are not prey to the devourer. We have so much to be thankful for. We do. And anyway, and here's a nice something else, she says. I was astonished. As I saw the jealousy indulge and listened to the words of envy, the reckless talk which made angels of God ashamed, words and actions and motives were recorded. And how little did these light, superficial heads and hard hearts realize that an angel of God stood at the door, writing down the manner in which these precious moments were employed. God will bring to light every word and every action. But here's the nice part. I was conducted to a few rooms from which came the voice of prayer. How welcome was the sight! A bright light shone upon the face of my guide as his hand traced every word of the petition. The eyes of the Lord are over the righteous, and his ears are open to the prayers. I know that all of you have prayed and prayed deeply and long and in early morning hours and late at night. If these prayers are truthful prayers, not feigned prayers, your angel is recording every word of it. It's in your manome. Now let's think of a person. Age 52, I chose 52 if we deduct 12. For the age of accountability, I know that's an arbitrary figure, but it leaves us with 40. 40 years of an accountable life, which translates to 14,600 days, not counting leap years, which translates to 233,600,000, is that right, waking hours, in which we are all thinking, doing, planning, speaking, etc. And these are just the hours in 40 years of daylight, of wake time. And then it translates to minutes and to seconds. And remember, in those huge volumes were only 3 million bases. And already, if we just do the minutes, we've got more than that in a year. So, each day, each hour of life, from childhood to youth, from youth to middle age, and onward to old age, our life history is being as faithfully recorded in the books of heaven as the polished plate of the artist reflects the features of the sitter. And so here we have the next slide, a picture of the human genome. And the next slide is another way of portraying it. It's a pixelated page, and each pixel is a base in the human genome. It would take 3,000 of these to depict the human genome. But our manome is huger. Sorry. More huge, most huge, whatever I can say, than this. And we can only remember a handful of it. So what do we do when we can't make right? It's there in heaven. It stands against us. How can we be assured that our sins will be blotted out and our names retained in the Lamb's Book of Life with all of this there? And the way is 5T. Well, I'm repeating what we read. You cannot make every case right. Going on down in these cases, the best you can do is bring a trespass offering to the Lord. Next slide, repeating this important thought. Let us shun every mean action, all dishonesty, all overreaching, and if anyone is guilty of wrong in this respect, let him confess his sin, make restitution to the one he has wronged, and in addition, bring a trespass offering to God, that when the times of refreshing shall come, his sins will be blotted out, may be blotted out, and his name retained. And if that doesn't happen, we are lost. We are lost. Is that the end? Oh, I wanted to just talk a little bit about the sin offering, because she also says we should bring a sin offering. And how can we do that? We don't have the sacrificial system anymore. Letter 39, 1874. The temple, acquiring costly offerings and sacrifices with its priests, is passed away. But the occasion for giving still exists while there are sinners to be saved and the poor to cry unto us, give. We are called upon to acknowledge the continual blessings and gifts of God's benevolent hand in the tithing system, as well as in sin offerings, trespass offerings, and free will offerings. We understand now trespass, free will, and tithe. But sin, she says, we are required in the sin offering. Next slide is a different source, manuscript 52, 1890. If all the rivulets from children and youth and from members of the church were to flow into the proper channel as the Lord designed they should, there would be a supply in the treasury. The real needy would be blessed, and the hungry fed, and the naked clothed. The Lord's own entrusted gifts would flow back to their original source in thank offerings, in sin offerings, in trespass offerings, and in gratitude offering for the great immeasurable gift of the Son of God to our world. So if you have been confused when you read, we are required to make a sin offering, it's financial, your financial resources. That's all I can tell you about that. But thank offerings, gratitude offerings, even the sin offerings, for the great immeasurable gift of the Son of God to our world. Here is Christ, manuscript 81, 1886. Here is Christ in the great antitypical day of atonement, and you must understand that you need a special preparation for the day of atonement. We want our sins taken away. We want to confess them, that they may go beforehand to judgment. Do not go away in discouragement, but believe that God is able to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. Another reference, your temper will be tried, your patience will be tested. Prayer alone and earnest faith will bring you through these things like a Christian. We shall fail often in our efforts to copy the divine pattern. We shall often have to bow down, to weep at the feet of Jesus because of our shortcomings and mistakes, but we are not to be discouraged. Pray more fervently, believe more fully, and try again with more steadfastness to grow into the likeness of your Lord. Oh, that we would remember it is court week with us, and that our cases are pending. And that's the end. And so this is the day of the final atonement. We don't know when the court of heaven, with our Father presiding, and Jesus, and I'll talk more about this tomorrow, and Jesus presenting, our case comes up. We don't know when it's going to move to that. But the important thing is we don't know that we're going to get home today or tomorrow or the next day. And our cases will be closed then. So in this preparation that we must make so that when our cases do come up, it involves thank offerings, free will offerings, tithing, gratitude offering, and the trespass offering. Because, not because God is arbitrary, but because when we have trespassed against one another, what have we done? We've trespassed against Him. And so when He asks for a trespass offering, it's to acknowledge we've done this to Him. And He will freely pardon us, but it is required. It will stand on our record without it. I can make, like Andreasen said, I can make confession, ask forgiveness, make even restitution, but it still stands according to what we've read. Until a trespass offering is made. It's that serious. And it's, I love all of you, and I don't want anything to stand between you and the Lord. Thank you. Yes. He was exonerated and resumed a life outside of prison.
Did the government make a trespass offering?
Oh, no. Remember, this is what, 1980s. No. And you know, we're facing a future of we're facing a future of false accusations against us. And remember Judge Key? He tried to subvert the process. We can't expect any better. But in this great preparation time, we can learn to be like Jesus. His grace is sufficient to teach us. Amen. If I look back 10 years, I'm a different person, praise God, and I'm sure all of you are. And but this process is going to end. And so we must be in earnest, and that's part of our desire for our little camp meeting, that we can realize the great and terrible day we're living in. We didn't ask to be here. You know, it might have been easier to live 100 years ago. I don't know, but I'm glad to be here. And we will praise God for eternity if we're faithful.